Thank you so much for joining us. I'm Tanya Fitzpatrick.
And I'm Ian Fitzpatrick, and this is World Footprints.
You know, we're all in the same boat right now. We're all in lockdown. And if you're a travel journalist, especially, you're probably going a bit stir crazy. And but our guest, Terri Marshall, who is a travel journalist as well, has some ideas for you guys. And I think they will help curb that wanderlust that's really kicking us all right now. So Terri, thank you so much for joining us again.
Well, thank you for having me. It's great to be here.
So let me ask you, how are you right now?
I'm feeling good. I'm getting lots of energy back, and that's a good thing because I was without it for a long time. So I feel like I'm on the downhill side of this thing, which is good.
Good deal. And I know you're in New York.
Right.
And I'm just curious, what's it like being in a quiet New York?
It's very strange. It's every once in a while I'll be out in the car, maybe pick up my husband from work when he's late, you know, late night. And there's no traffic on the West Side Highway, which is just unimaginable. You know, there's nobody in Times Square except police officers. And I don't know. I don't know if we're going to be able to get used to the traffic again when it comes back. But right now I would welcome it.
Now, Terri, with everyone being on lockdown and no one's able to go anywhere, how are you staying engaged with travel?
I like to think about the future is one of the ways. But in the meantime, I've been very impressed with a lot of the destinations that are showing us what they have through virtual technology, which is what we have the most of right now, as you know. So just, you know, Google Arts and Culture have done a wonderful job of putting together, you know, different virtual museum visits, virtual concerts, and things like that through different entities. That has made a difference for me. I'm a big wildlife fan, and I went to Tanzania a couple years ago and just absolutely loved it. And so when I heard about the one website called explore.org that you can just sign up for their newsletter, and it's a free website. You can literally watch webcams in Africa. And I'm telling you, don't do it unless you have hours that you don't need to do anything. Because I really got so entranced by watching a family of elephants, you know, bathing, and there was a night over there at the time, and feed, you know, drinking the water and bathing. I couldn't take my eyes off of it. So, but you know what? That's a good escape. And that's what travel is anyway, in a lot of ways. 7, and it's not just Africa. They have polar bears. I was watching a family, a mama with some baby cubs, and that was just intriguing as well. And then I saw another night, I was watching monkeys in a tree that were sleeping. And it's just so reassuring to know that the wildlife is out there, and you know, things, there are some things that are still the same.
Well, and you know, in many parts, I'm sure wildlife is coming back in bigger force too these days.
Yes, I think they're very happy. I had read something the other day, you may have read it, in Yellowstone Park, the people who are essential workers who are there were saying that they have quadrupled the number of bears that they're seeing right now because the crowds aren't there. So the animals have taken the park over again, which is really how it should be. So they're probably enjoying this little break from humanity.
I'm sure they are, and so, you know, and hopefully when the world does open up for us again, we'll be a little bit more conscientious and responsible.
I hope so. I do hope so.
Now, I know you do a lot of multi-generational travel. You write about a lot of multi-generational mm-hmm. travel, and so for, say, a family who wants to engage in travel, do you have some tips for them?
Well, yes, I do a lot of that. I plan at least once a year, I plan a trip for all four generations of my family because my parents are fortunately still with us. And so then I have my brother and then my children and grandchildren. So there's four generations, which is a lot of fun, a little difficult to coordinate the schedules, but we do it at least once a year. But then I do a good bit of travel in the summertime, usually with the grandkids. And then sometimes it's just, you know, my brother and I will take my mom and dad somewhere, which we had done in the past. And, you know, I think it depends on the family. We tend to do really well with finding a place where we can kind of call it home base, whether it's at a beach or on an island or something like that, or even a, you know, rent a house from Airbnb or something like that, that we have room together. And then we have time to do our own things during the day, because there's, gosh, 13 of us now, I guess. I may be counting that wrong. So, but anyway, it's good to have some time to do your own interest, but also good to come back together for your evening meal and for your mornings and play games or whatever you like to do. So I guess my one tip to people would be to figure out what works for your family. I know that traipsing around sightseeing would not work for all of us at the same time, because we have different interests and also because of different attention spans. So mm-hmm. that's a big thing to consider if you want to enjoy that time together and not have to worry about people being unhappy. So the beach works well. That's always good, because people can read or they can play in the water, or, you know, everyone has their own thing. So that's one of my big tips always for multi-gen travel. And of course, right now we're having to put a hold on that because so many people are at risk. So, but we'll get it back.
Now, speaking of multi-generational travel, as we look to the future, how do you see the current times we find ourselves in impacting how you may choose to travel with your extended family in years to come?
Well, I think for me, and this may be true for a lot of people, it will depend on what part of the family we're talking about. Because I think my parents are getting a little uncomfortable with travel after going through all of this. You know, their daddy's in his 80s, mama's not quite there. But they're, I think just knowing the health risk and things that can happen, they're probably going to be a little more comfortable with us coming to them, which we had planned to do anyway in June, which I don't know if it's going to happen now. But they live in Chattanooga, Tennessee, and there's a lot of things to do there. And they have a home big enough that we can all stay with them. And then everyone goes out and does what they like. Like I've mentioned before, during the day, the kids can go to a climbing gym or to the aquarium. You know, my brother and his husband love to go antiquing. You know, Greg and I are usually going out for a hike or maybe with the grandkids. So, you know, it works. And I think for them, going to the place that they're comfortable, if you have older relatives that feel comfortable, because I think this is really kind of shaking some people, especially with flights, you know, that would be very difficult. And also just being in the car that long once you get older gets a little bit difficult as well. For me, with the generation of traveling with my grandchildren or my children, it's a little different because, you know, I'm pretty adventurous, as you know, and I really want to introduce them to some of the places I've been that are my favorites. So what I will probably do is make a little more of a priority of that going forward, just because I feel like, I don't know if you guys feel this way, but I kind of feel like nothing is certain. You know, I've always just taken travel for granted, and now I can't. And so I think maybe that will inspire me to really get those things on the calendar every year and make sure we do some of those things that they really wanted to try.
Yeah, indeed. I mean, I think a lot of people are seeing how much more important being connected to family members is these days, because I think many of us have taken those connections and just our travel opportunities for granted. Especially as travel journalists, you know, we've been blessed to go so many different places that we right. couldn't have gone on our own. So, you know, a lot of people may think, oh, you know, when they think about multi-generational travel, they may think, oh, I don't want to travel with, you know, my grandma or my mom or my, you know, especially teenagers.
Right.
What do you see, or what would you tell people the value of multi-generational travel is?
Well, there's a reason I said before that I always pick a place where everyone can do their own thing during the day, because that keeps us all happy, you know. But I think the value comes in being in a place where you can all come together, whether it be in the morning or in the morning and the evening, just to talk, you know, having that evening meal together and just having conversations, even if you only spend that part of the day with every person in the same room. It makes a difference, because that's your time to reconnect. And with us, we don't live in the same, none of us live in the same cities. So it's very important for us to have that. But I think with anyone, just to have that time, sometimes our best laughs and the fun memories we have that my kids had with their grandparents when they were growing up, and now my grandkids have it of their great grandparents, are just playing games like Phase 10, a card game, or some silly thing like that where you can, you know, laugh and make jokes and, you know, just be unplanned and hang out. And I think that's why it's important to stay in a place together as opposed to, say, hotel rooms, unless they're adjoining where you have a common area. That just seems to work for us. And that eliminates you having to do things during the day that half the group doesn't want to do, you know, together. So.
Now, is there a favorite memory you have with the grandkids around travel?
Oh, there's so many. Mine are, fortunately, they're getting to the age where they're easy to travel with. They've always been good travelers, but they're 12, if I get this right, they keep changing on me, 12, 10, and 9. So, but I say that last summer, I took all three of them to, we were outside of Charleston at the Wild Dunes Resort, and we had a like a little condo that we stayed in. And my daughter came because she brought my grandson up from Florida. I had the two older with me for a week or so before that. So we all joined together there. And one of the things we did was crab safari. So we went on this boat with this dog named Moses. He was the owner's dog. And Moses has a knack for hearing dolphins because he's always been a boating dog. So he would start this running across the boat and usually jumping in the boys' laps every time he heard a dolphin, and then the dolphins would appear. It was the craziest thing I've ever seen. But the kids were just, you know, giggling and laughing and having so much fun. And then we were, you know, out on the beach and they were, you know, trying to figure out how to catch the crabs by throwing these, you know, fish with a pole in and all this kind of stuff. But just watching them try to figure it out and then, you know, have their mishaps and lose the crabs or lose the fish. And at one point, Benjamin was being chased by a bird and he was running down the beach screaming, Gigi, the bird, the bird. I said, well, drop the fish. That's what the bird wants. You know, just, I mean, it was hilarious, but it was like, they still talk about it. And, you know, after we were done, they cooked the crabs on the beach and, you know, the kids were like, this is the best food ever. And, you know, it's those kind of memories that are going to be priceless. And, you know, I'll remind them of them as they become real teenagers so that they'll remember that I was once cool.
Yeah. I think you'll always be cool, my dear.
Well, I don't know. Well, ask the kids in about 3 years.
We'll show them this this interview.
Please do, yes.
So when I ask you before we go, if you could sit next to anyone traveling anywhere on an airplane, who would that be, past or present?
Oh my goodness. Let me think about this. Oh, that's hard. I want a big group of people. I would say maybe Maya Angelou, because I love her, just her quotes, her writing, and just her general view of life and the world. And I think if we could have a good long flight together, a long one, that would be a good chance to ask her how she maintained that positive approach over the years. I think she'd be a wonderful person to spend some time with in flight.
Oh, bless. I agree. Well, thank you, Terri, so much for sharing these great travel tips with us. And hopefully, you know, people will at least start thinking about traveling. We can't now, and it's for a good reason.
Right.
But we'll be able to again soon.
Yes, and as they're saying on that hashtag, dream now, travel later. So we'll all do it again. Thank you for having me.
Thank you, Terri.